Isaiah chapter 9, and I'm going to deviate from that just a little bit this morning, and I will pick back up on that message in a couple of weeks and continue with the names of God and the characteristics of God. But this morning I want to just be a little more traditional and look from the book of Matthew chapter 2 and the familiar Christmas story, but maybe look at a couple of things that you may or may not have considered before from the Christmas story that maybe will serve as a challenge and a reminder to all of us about sharing our faith. I have a good friend that is the pastor of the Calvary Church of Heber Springs, and we have a mutual friend that's in the hospital right now, and I was visiting with him last night on the phone, and he has taken a lot of slack this past week for a statement that he made, and he's gotten a lot of grief for it, and I guess people thought that, you all know the big controversy over the Dynasty crew, but anyway, he made the statement that I wish people would get as excited about sharing their faith as they've gotten excited about Field getting kicked off of A&E. And of course, people thought he was taken up for those that kicked him off, and that's not neither here nor there. What he was doing really wasn't part of it. He just was just making the fact that he wished people would get excited about sharing their faith, about the success of sharing Jesus Christ. And so we visited about that for a while and talked. But this morning, I want us to just be reminded from the Christmas story about the extremities that God goes to reveal himself to mankind and to the world. If you would stand with me this morning for the reading of God's Word in Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Beginning in verse 1, it says, Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who is born king of the Jews? For we have seen a star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search carefully for the young child, and when you found him, bring back word to me, that I may come and worship him also. And when they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, being divinely warned in a dream they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. The story of the wise men visiting the Christ child is something that I want us to focus on for just a few minutes tonight or this morning, because I got to thinking about this, and really I began this because I've been preaching a series of messages from Matthew on Sunday nights, and I kind of got stuck on the Magi, on the wise men this year, and I've never done that at Christmas before, but I kind of got stuck on them and thinking about the things that concerned them and how they found the Lord, and it intrigued me a little bit. And so I want to focus on that for a few minutes. Pray with me if you would. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that God, you would help us, Lord, to glean from these scriptures that we read and have read year in and year out, those of us that, Lord, regularly attend your house and serve you and worship you. And sometimes we just become so familiar with these stories that, Lord, that maybe we miss the finer points. And I pray that, Lord, that you would help us this morning. Let our hearts be challenged by what we read. And let us, Lord, be emboldened to share the word. And, Lord, to use every avenue and every opportunity. Lord, we pray that, Lord, you would find in us, Lord, a truly worshipful spirit, Lord, even as was found, Lord, in these individuals. We ask it in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, these individuals, these Magi, These men, as we sang about and you told the story, you know that they began a long trip to Israel. And they began this trip or this pilgrimage to Israel because a particular star was in the sky. And that particular star had alerted them to the birth of the King of the Jews. Now that in itself intrigues me, and there's a lot of things that we can explore about that. But these men traveled for several months, really, before they finally meet the Christ child in person. They just started out on a long journey and traveled great distances following this star. Now, I believe that it is more than just a story that's meant to entertain us. We use it sometimes as entertainment, it seems, at Christmas time to retell the story or to do a play and reenact the Magi and those kind of things. But I believe that it's meant to teach us something about seeking Jesus Christ. And you know, the thing is that we need to be reminded that those that seek Christ will find Christ. We need to be reminded of that. If you want to know Christ, if you will seek out to know Him, He will reveal Himself to you. In fact, the Bible promises as much. And so I seen a window sticker on a truck this week, and the man had on there, said, "Wise men still seek Him." And I want you to know that's the absolute truth. Wise men do still seek Him, at least the ones that are wise. And so, and several things crossed my mind about these wise men, and one of the funny things that crossed my mind as I was thinking about this is what would have been different on their trip to Jerusalem if it had been wise women seeking the Christ child rather than wise men. I would have to believe that they probably would have stopped and asked for directions much sooner than they did. I think that they probably would not have arrived so late. You know, if you've read the story, really they didn't get there right when he was born. It was sometime later that they arrived, and so if the women had been seeking him, they would have not only not been late, they would have been on time, and in time probably to help deliver the baby. And clean the stable and do some things for the family, like make a casserole,
just getting in deeper.
And dine ready. And of course there would have been peace on earth, right? And so things might have been a little different if been women seeking him. But this morning I want to talk about the lessons that we learned from the wise men seeking him. And the first thing that intrigues me about these wise men or these magi, or the thing that stands out to me that I think you and I should be challenged by, is that God Himself makes every effort, I believe, to reach every person that is far away from Him. You know, you and I give up on people pretty easily. You and I kind of have, if we're honest, we really have a tunnel vision about who can be saved and what saved people look like and who should even be attempted to be witnessed to and those kind of things. But I find in the scriptures that God makes every effort in every way to reach every person that is far away from Him. And here we find that God used the star to reach. Now I want you to understand about these Magi. If you think they were Jewish, you're wrong. The fact of the matter is that they were pagans. These individuals were pagans. And in fact, not only were they pagan, but they were Gentile magicians, if you would. These individuals were astrologers, and we find that, isn't it interesting that God would use a star to reach out to pagans, Gentile magicians, individuals who were nowhere near being religious or even being in a right relationship with God. And the first we read of these wise men is when they reached Jerusalem, which is the Jewish capital. And it tells us in those scriptures that we just read that Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and they asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw a star in the east," and they said, "We have come to worship him." So we find that these wise men, these pagan Gentile magicians, were on a mission. And they were on a mission to find the newborn King of the Jews. And interesting enough, they came to worship him. Now, what's fascinating about these men is what I believe they have to teach us about God, and the fact that God does make every effort to reach every person, no matter how far away they are from Him. Now, as I've said, we have to remember those things that I've already mentioned, that they were Gentiles, that they were not Jews that were coming to seek and to worship the King of Jews. The Jews, if you know your Bible and have studied it any, you know that the Jews thought that the promised Messiah was only for the Jews. They thought the promised Messiah was only coming for them, and that He was not for the Gentiles. Now, there was a way in the Old Testament for Gentiles to become part of the Jewish community, but they were always kind of second class. There was always a different courtyard for them, and there was always a different system, but they could be considered part of the household of faith. And the reason being is it was always their mission to prepare the world for the coming of the Messiah, but they failed in that mission. And so we find that Christ, we know that Christ would deliver us from our sins, but we find that the first followers of Christ, if you go back and study your Bible, really was almost exclusively Jewish. And we know that they thought that the Messiah would deliver them from the Roman Empire, from their oppressors. And yet the signal to the wise men, I believe, was that God was calling more than just Jewish believers, that God was also calling Gentile believers. And so, and it's interesting that they didn't even share the religion of the Jews. These were magi, which was kind of a combination of a learned scientist and an astrologer, is what I discovered about them. And they knew science as well as magic. And they were kind of the academians of their time. But they were still magicians / astrologers who practiced things that would have been strictly forbidden by the people of God. And so we find that what this tells us, I believe, about God and should be an encouragement to you and I is that God abandons no one. God abandons no one. The fact of the matter is that every lost soul is important to God. Every lost soul is a soul that He wants to have Himself revealed to. And I believe that if God can reach pagan Gentile astrologers, I believe that He is still working on people that you and I may think are too far gone. And sometimes I think that we get to thinking like that. I think we get that kind of tunnel vision where we just don't believe that God would ever use that person or would ever reach that person. And yet we're reminded again and again that God doesn't give up. And in this case, God sent these men a message using this star, an astronomical event, a star that would signal to them that they needed to search for this child born as the King of the Jews. And even though God said in His Word, and I'm paraphrasing, that astrology is wrong, it's interesting to me that He still used what these men knew to lead them to Himself. He used what these men knew, a star, to lead them to Himself. And so God used the language that they understood. I want you to know that God is a God with a missionary heart, is what I'm getting at. God is a God with a missionary heart, and He meets people right where they're at, and no, nothing is a barrier to Him. No language, no culture, nothing is a barrier to God and His determination and desire to reach all men. Now, perhaps if an angel had appeared to them, you remember who appeared to the shepherds, was not a star, but an angel appeared to the shepherds, and if an angel had appeared to these individuals, it might have been misinterpreted. But God, He knew the best way to reach these men. He knew what they would heed to. He knew what they would read into it. And so God used the star as a way to bring the Magi to Christ. Now, when I think about that, I have to remind myself that not everyone is raised in church. Not everybody knows church language, and they don't all understand their need to seek Jesus. And you know, we that have been around the church a long time, and we're familiar with church language and church symbols and all of those kind of things, we're baffled by why people don't participate in church. But really, a lot of times it's because I'm discovering that there's lots of people that just have no foundation about church. There are still a lot of people out there, and even increasingly so in the culture and in the day and time that we're in, that it, as children, it's just not part of their upbringing. It's why it makes what we do with our children when we bring them to church so important, that we give them a foundation, that they understand the Bible and the Word of God. But there's lots of people that don't know why they're supposed to seek God. And so God comes in ways that He can be understood, in ways that He can reveal to people their need for God. In fact, I believe it's why God came in the flesh. God came in the flesh so that He could be like one of us. He could talk to you and I in our own language. He could be like us so that He could reach us and that we could reach other people. I don't know about you, but it's comforting to me to know that God isn't just up on high with no ability to identify with me or my struggles or any of those things. And I think sometimes it's the difference in somebody actually being able to sympathize with another person when they've been there and they've been through it. It's why some of the struggles that you go through are so important, whether you realize it or not, because at some point, God, if you're a Christian, God will use that to minister to somebody else that's going through a hard time. And it'll have meaning to them when they find that you didn't waver in your faith, you didn't give up on God, but even when things were impossible, you kept pressing through and turning to God and believing Him, and that God delivered you. And so we find that the same thing is with Jesus Christ. No matter how difficult it got, and it got more difficult than anything any of us have ever faced, Jesus completed the mission and the will of God. And because He faced the same struggles that you and I face, and because He suffered those infirmities, He suffered our sin and took it upon Himself, though He knew no sin Himself, He's able to identify with you and I. And so I believe that we need to remember this, and you and I ought to, this Christmas season, stop and think of someone that we think has gone too far or that's outside of God's reach. I am blessed when I see the hand of God working in individuals. And I've often said the thing about witnessing is that oftentimes it's not even the person that I've selected to witness to or even felt led to witness to that always receives Christ. God always astounds me, and it winds up being somebody that I didn't even think would listen if I witnessed to him in the first place. And yet God over and over showing me that He's the one that does the convicting. He's the one that does the convincing. He's the one that does the saving. You and I are just vessels that God uses. Amen?
Amen.
And so we find that God is at work in individuals, and I'm reminded that God continues to love everyone. That doesn't mean everyone's saved. But I want to tell you, God really does love the whole world. He really did give Himself for the world. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. I think we forget that. I think we think that God so loves the church. We think that God, and He does love the church. But you know what? We're part of the church because of Jesus Christ, not because of anything in us. We're in the church because of the accomplishments of Jesus Christ. And so the Magi kind of teach us this lesson. And then the second thing that I see from these men is that God really does want us to seek Him. Not just barely seek Him, but diligently seek Him. We need more than just a knowledge about Christ. We need to seek Christ. You know, what I find is that as I look at what these wise men teach us, it's this very thing. And what we need to realize is that it's not enough just to know about Jesus, but that we need to have a relationship with Jesus. And I think that sometimes where people fall short is that we think that because we know about Jesus. There are lots of people that know the Bible story. They know what Jesus came to do. They know all the facts that surround it, but they don't really know Jesus in a personal way. They haven't really sought anything. These men sought out Jesus. These men paid a great price. They traveled far to have that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And yet, on the other hand, we see the religious community there in Jerusalem, people that were like the church, that had a very firm grasp on the Word of God, supposedly, people who were touting that they were living out the letter of the law as it was written in the Scripture. They did all the rituals. They were following all the commandments. They knew about God. They knew everything that had been revealed. Yet, when these wise men show up, Herod and all these religious leaders were stunned to find out that the Messiah had been born. And in fact, the Scripture, if you look there, said that all of Jerusalem was troubled. All of Jerusalem was disturbed. Here we find that the very people who should have been looking for him, who were the closest, who should have been seeking him, they didn't even realize that the Messiah had been born. They didn't even realize the Christ child had arrived. And when they heard the news from the Magi, they were disturbed about it. You know, somehow I think about that with us. I think that sometimes as a church, we're so familiar with all the trappings and all the ritual that we come to church and we feel like because we gave our hour on Sunday morning that somehow we have done our duty, that we have sought Christ. But the fact of the matter is that God is not interested in a religion. What God wants is a relationship. God wants a personal relationship with the people of God. And so, but yet the tendency of church is a lot of times for us to turn everything into a ritual, for us to turn everything into an expectation. Recently I had an uncle that kind of stunned me a little bit. Maybe I stunned him, but I said, you know, I've learned that you don't have to wear a necktie to be a preacher. For years, I thought you had to. And in fact, I read a story of a missionary. He said he went to Africa, and he said that he was stunned that he got there in the middle of Africa in the jungle where people barely had clothes. He said when they went to church on Sunday morning, though, he said everybody came in suits and ties, looked just like they did back in America. The ladies wore dresses, and they didn't sing songs in their native language. They sang American songs. And when he got to asking the people why they did this, they said, well, when the missionaries came here back in the 70s, they told us this is how you have church. And this is how you have church. And this is what church people look like. And this is what church people act like. And this is what they do. And you know what? We perpetuate that sometimes. The fact of the matter is, God's not interested in a religion. What God is interested in is a relationship. And we find that if you want to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we have to diligently seek Him. We have to diligently seek Him. And we find that these Magi did that. They diligently sought the Lord out. And, you know, it reminds me of the verse in Hebrews. Or first, it reminds me of Jesus. When He said this, Jesus said, seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be open. In other words, if you look, you're going to find me. And then the author of Hebrews wrote, he said, and without faith it's impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists, and He rewards those, what? Who earnestly seek Him. And so we need to take that encouragement. We need to think about it. Are we diligently seeking Christ? Or are we just engaged in religion? Are we just engaged in ritual? Or are we diligently seeking a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? The third thing that I notice from these wise men, and it bothers me that I don't learn it from the church at large in Jerusalem. I don't learn it from the religious leaders. I learn it from some individuals who would not fit the mold. Individuals who God, in most people's estimation, should have never reached out to. But we find from these individuals that they came to worship Christ. They came to worship Christ. You know, that's the thing about it is that it is still, Christ still desires to be worshiped. And God is pleased when we worship His Son, Jesus Christ. God is worshiped through His Son, Jesus Christ, being worshiped. You know, the fact of the matter is that we can study all of our Bible, but everything we need to know about God is summed up in Jesus Christ. We know when we seek Him, we worship Him and know Him, we know God. And we find that from the Magi. And what we find is that in their worship, they offered valuable things to God. We know that, we should know that worship is not an option. Once these wise men reached Jesus, it says that the first thing they did was to worship. Just like the shepherds did who had already visited, these wise men came and worshiped. In Matthew 2:11, it says, on coming into the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented to him with gifts of gold and of incense and myrrh. And so we find that not only did they worship him, but they bowed down and worshiped him. In other words, they humbled themselves before Christ. Now, I still find that all interesting that these men who were of a different religion, that God led them to worship through their language a star. And when they came, they realized who he was, and they had enough sense to know that Christ needed to be worshipped, and that they bowed down and they worshipped. Now, with the Bible, I just believe from what I'm reading that these individuals did convert. I believe these individuals did recognize him as the Savior of the world. And when I look at what they brought him, I see that their worship consisted of expensive gifts. They were very valuable gifts. They were costly gifts. They were gifts that were deserving of a king. And when you look at these different things that were offered, it signaled, I believe, submission on their part. And I wonder if what we bring valuable in our offerings. I wonder what we bring valuable in our worship to God. You know, I think that sometimes we don't look at that enough. But the first thing that I see that they brought that was worthy of a king was gold. And gold, we know, was just as valuable as it is now. And the fact of the matter is, it's very valuable. And we find that they brought their gold to Christ. They brought it to him. And then we find that not only did they bring the gold, but they brought frankincense, which was a fragrant scent that was offered to God during sacrificial worship. And interesting enough, in the Old Testament, it could only be offered to God by a priest, and we know now Jesus is called our high priest. And then myrrh, they brought myrrh that was used in the preparation for burial. And I go over these things because it was costly to them. You know, I think the thing that God wants that is costly to all of us is that he wants all of us. He wants everything. He doesn't just want part of us. He wants everything. And you know what? The fact of the matter is that it costs us something, and it should cost us something. It's like an individual that one time I met, and they wanted to send something significant to a funeral, some flowers, and I had offered to help with it, and he said no, because I knew he didn't have a lot of money, and it was a family member that died. And I'd offered to help the flowers, and he said no. He said, you know what, that individual was significant to me. And he said, it ought to cost me something. It ought to cost me something to show how significant they were to me. And you know what, it's going to cost us something to show how significant Christ is to us. And the thing that's going to cost us is our entire life. Amen? To lay it all down at his feet. And that the fourth thing, and I know I'm kind of rambling a little bit this morning. It's not really what I was going to preach, but it just kind of caught my attention. I began to just think about some of these things and wonder about what am I laying down at Jesus' feet? You know, what am I offering him that's costing me? What am I, does he really see worship in what I'm offering? You know, is it really? And you know, sometimes I think just something we ought to think about. The fourth thing is that I believe that we need to continue to be open to God's Spirit. You know, I told you that I think that these Magi got converted. I don't believe they came and found the Christ child and then went back to their pagan religion. I don't believe that's what happened to them. You say, well, how could you gather that from Scripture? Well, first of all, I believe that when we come and we truly bow down to Christ, I believe that though we can come just like we are, and I believe God reaches out to us right where we're at. He'll speak to us in our culture. He'll speak to us in our language. He'll speak to us in our situation. But he never leaves us where he finds us. And I believe that one, now that doesn't mean that we're going to start dressing like everybody thinks everybody ought to dress on Sunday morning, or that, you know, that we're going to do the rituals because they've been adopted the way that it says this is the way you have church. But the fact of the matter is that in your heart, he's not going to leave you the way that he finds you. And the fact of the matter is that I think there's a telltale sign. I believe there's evidence. And I believe the evidence that you've truly met Christ and that you've begun to worship him and that you've started a relationship with him is that when your heart becomes obedient to him. I believe that when you become obedient to the voice and to the word of God, I believe that a conversion has occurred. I believe that you'll hear his voice. He says, my sheep will hear my voice. They'll know my voice. And I believe that we see that in this story because you know what? The star is not the only time that God ever spoke to these wise men. We find that the wise men obeyed God's direction by not returning to Herod. You see, the journey to Christ, the reward of faith, I believe, taught them that they needed to remain open to the leading of God. And I believe that they learned to listen to the voice of God. And I believe that points to the fact that they probably had begun that relationship with God. In Matthew 2:12 it says, and having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Now, I want to tell you this. The thing is this, is that there's never going to come to a point in our life where we ever stop needing or should be listening to the direction of God for our lives. The fact of the matter is that I believe that it's evidence of our relationship with God when we do follow his direction. And I believe that God still does speak to his people. And I believe that God still gives direction for our lives. And I believe that he still leads us. And just like he led the Magi. And so I believe what that means is that seeking God doesn't end with meeting Christ. Seeking God doesn't end with the first time that we meet Christ or just meeting together on a regular basis. I believe that we have to continue to be open for God to speak to us. And again, I believe that if we seek him, that we'll find him. And I believe that if we're diligently seeking him, that means that we're worshiping him. And I believe that when we're worshiping him, I believe that means that it's costing us something. And I believe that not only that, but when we do that, we need to be remaining open to what God's telling us, what he's saying to us in our hearts. And so that kind of, that scripture kind of, those familiar verses that I've read lots of times just kind of began to speak to me. And about how the church, how we need to be reaching out. We need to stop putting God in a box about how he can speak to people and the things that he can use to speak through. The fact of the matter is that God, anybody that's far away from God, he'll use whatever means are necessary to reach that individual. He'll use whatever means are necessary to get that individual's attention. And we need to stop limiting him and putting him in a box on how he will do that. And you know what? He'll take people anywhere he finds them, but he never leaves them the same. The fact of the matter is that he converts them in their heart. Amen? Amen. And so you and I ought to be challenged. We ought to be challenged. Who's somebody that we'd give up on? You know, one of the greatest things of the Christmas, you know, we talk about giving gifts, and that's supposed to be symbolic of God giving the greatest gift that we've ever received. But the truth of the matter is that we still have the greatest gift that was ever given that needs to be shared. Amen? And so you and I need to think about who is that person that's too far gone. That person that would we would never believe that God could ever reach. I know that there have been individuals that have been and I hate to say this, but I believe some people have to go to prison for God to get their attention. I believe that some people have to go to the hospital for God to get their attention. How many of you know God speaks through hospitals all the time? Amen? Yeah. How many of you know that God really does speak through prisons all the time?
Yeah.
All the time, people that are in prison, God uses that experience and that place. God uses, he will use whatever means are necessary. Sometimes people have to go through a financial ruin. God can speak through financial ruin to cause people to finally begin to seek him. God will use whatever means are necessary. Nobody is ever too far out or too far gone. God can use those things. Does that mean everybody in prison that claims Jesus Christ is born again? Absolutely not. Neither is everybody that's in church this morning.
Yeah.
And so what we have to realize is that God really is still calling men, and He still is saving souls. And we really do have the best gift, the greatest gift that's ever been given to share. Amen?
Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, this morning we thank You for Your Word. And we thank You, Lord, for the simplicity of Your Word. And Lord, just for some of the simple truths that sometimes we miss, or that we gloss over, or downright ignore. And Lord, I pray that You would give each of us the same missionary heart that You have. And I pray, God, that You would just, Lord, motivate each of us with the same love, the same agape love, that, Lord, that motivated Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank You this morning. We thank You for, Lord, the greatest thing that we've ever known. And we pray, Lord, that You find us compelled to share it with the world, share it in the places that You've put us. And Lord, we pray that You would burden us again, Lord, with someone that's lost, with someone that needs to know You. Lord, we ask these things according to Your will, and we ask them in Jesus Christ's holy name, and all the people said amen.
Amen.
Just your head still bowed for a minute. Don't get up for a second. Are you here this morning? You know, I look across the congregation, and the one thing that I'm guilty of is I think, you know, a lot of times I'm preaching to the choir, and I think everyone here is saved, but you know what? I have no way of knowing that. And you may be in this place today, and maybe you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, or maybe you haven't been seeking Him like you should. And this morning you've been reminded that it's not enough just to know about Christ, but that you need to know Him in a personal way. I want to challenge you to seek Him and begin today, to seek Him in a personal relationship. And if you'll do that, I guarantee you will find Him. I wonder this morning if you're here and say, "Brother Ron, pray for me. It's my spiritual state. I have some needs." Would you lift your hand this morning and just say, "Brother Ron, God bless you. God bless you."